Mini chapter 51, Kelly smudges Kim. As these freshly feathered visuals of Kim come blinking out into their first emergence from code, Jamie can sense Kelly waiting for them, ready to pounce and smudge. Tapping away at her image editing software in the factory place loft, she is now subtler in her approach, compared with when she propelled Evelyn into an agonizing isolation of self-consciousness among her friends at the downstairs bar, or even compared with when she handed Shigim an on-screen talk show version of himself in the nightclub coat check line. In approaching Kim here, she insinuates herself into her target's environment with wicked smoothness, then deft enticement. There, look. She's dropped an unintrusive image of her own perky self into the imagination thief's visuals. Walking past Kim in his university's careers center, he is sitting at a screen, peering foggily at pages that purport to describe the only options he will have when he leaves college in the not-too-distant future. He has no idea which line of country to plump for, feeling all these corporate options to be unnatural, and finding it difficult, frankly, to picture himself in any of them. "Just let me know if I can be of any help," says the besuited advisor passing him by, a youngish black woman with a perky smile. He takes in the name tag on her lapel. "Kelly Candy, careers director." "In fact," she continues, "I bet I can help, because I'd say you look a bit undecided, and I know about this stuff. Fancy a quick chat in my office? Why not?" Well, why indeed would he say no? Can't do any harm, can it? He may as well hear her information, at least, since it has to be admitted this plumping for a career business will have a huge and unpredictable effect on his entire life. So he follows her, oblivious to Jamie's furious gesticulations high above him, semaphored in vain from behind the railing at the bottom of a side aisle in the gods, that he not follow Kelly, please not. Within a few minutes, she has looked through Kim's college student CV, has had a sensible chat with him, and is beginning to steer him with impeccable professionalism towards a career that will begin on the trading floor of an investment bank. She conveys an accurate outline of the generous salary progression he can expect in such a career if he demonstrates the kind of talent she reckons he has. It is correct information she gives him. He's not about to make such a decision right now, but what she's saying does sound reasonable. If he were to plump for this option, then at any rate it would hardly be a silly choice. This much could be said. Kelly riffles through a neat line of brochures on her desk and pulls out one of the glossiest. "I hear Bangdead Investments are doing well," she says, holding it up. "I'd give them a call. I know the hirers in their hedge fund division, as it happens, so by all means tell them I suggested you. I'm sure they'll be looking for bright-eyed recruits like yourself. In fact, there you are, pictured on the cover of the brochure. Look, Kim, they're waiting for you." He takes hold of the glossy paper, and an extraordinary feeling spreads through him to see she is right. That is him, Kim Somerville, in sharp focus on the cover of the Banged Investments recruitment brochure. His favourite fuzzy smooth white sweater and bright blue jeans have both been ripped off him and folded away somewhere, replaced here by a sharp designer suit and a killer tie. And the nervous, nail-biting side of him that he's always had to wrestle with has clearly been banished from the young man in this photo. But it's him, all right, standing in the financial district of New York City, staring up at a sunlit skyscraper in fresh-faced aspiration, looking like a wholesome blonde pop star whose real passion is to make a killing through a lightning-fast trajectory up that tower, high above the trading floors to those penthouse-suite corner offices he can see glinting in the Manhattan sky. He flicks through the brochure, catching sight of upbeat headings such as career progression, collegial company culture, and survival of the fittest, and recognizes himself on several more pages. In one photo, he's taking modest pride in showing a group of clients the remarkable progress of a line rising across a graph. In a second one, he and a colleague are peering avidly at a list of prices on a screen. And in a third one, it's evident that his corporate polish and the size of his trainee rainmaker salary have also been helpful in getting him the girl, as a brassy-eyed print model in the background fires an admiring smolder at him through a bedroom doorway in his swanky-looking future home. Jamie has been shaking the digital bars of his railing up in the gods, trying to catch Kim's attention so as to warn him away from Kelly's treacherous blandishments, but in vain. At last, Jamie abandons these analog gesticulations, realizing there's a better mode of communication with his beast. Kim's mobile phone flashes and vibrates on the office chair beside him. His eyes flick to its screen and see an incoming text from his creator. The text reads, "Peel them back." Kim glances up at Kelly, whose bland face is distracted with reading something on her computer screen. He looks down at Jamie's text again. Yes, it comprises that three-word instruction and nothing more. He focuses on the brochure in his hands. He closes it, examining its stapled spine, and frowns at the square cover picture of himself staring up at the skyscraper. At the very bottom left corner of this photo, the topmost layer of ultra-glossy photographic paper has come loose and sprung back upon itself, so a tiny triangle of thin translucent plastic is curled over to point towards the centre of the image. Jamie has told him what to do next. He peels the tiny triangle back, pulling the plastic easily off the entire photo, and he can smell the blood that fills his skin in that skyscraper scene. He can feel the pressure where that eager young face oozes tears inside itself, ready to squeeze out from his tear ducts into the aspirational sunlight. Within his wholesome pop star physiognomy is a sharp, fearful face, with green around its blazing eyes and red around its mouth. Its outside colours are just a wrapping, and even they have changed as the truth of him is laid ever barer. The skin around his eyes is now a rubbery ultramarine, his irises a sexily unhealthy ochre orange, and the whites of his eyes stand out bright against that ultramarine convexity of skin, like egg yolks in an outspread dark blue fried egg blubber. He flips this front cover over in haste, and the brochure falls open at the shot of him showing a graph to a group of clients. Again, the topmost layer of gloss at the image's extreme bottom left corner is curled over. His fingernails dive in to peel this one back, and straight away those corporate clients are corpses in waiting, unalive, the chewing dead. Tears roll down in the photo as he stares, from one corpse's black ringed eyes, over stretched out cheekbones, down to a black tongue. And there beside the clients, Kim himself evokes that painting of the terrible-eyed victim of premature burial, raising the lid of its coffin and reaching out in horror into the air of a crypt. Oh yes, Kim knows the painting. Buried so far beyond rescue that the crypt's floor may as well have caved in too, propelling him down to a cavern underneath. And he sees his blonde hair and recalls how hair keeps growing for a little while after a corpse in waiting has become a corpse. Flicking on through the brochure, he peels back the shot of him peering with a colleague at the prices on the screen, and the cause of his poisonous headache in the photo is revealed. Stroking his shallowly buried skull as if to stroke the lobes inside it, the price-checking Kim becomes aware of the shape of that skull just inside him, and he can feel the spider legs living among his brain lobes. The entire head of his colleague at the screen, however, has turned into a wriggling spider, its body alone the size of the colleague's head, while its legs wave around like hirsute antlers. Kim wrenches the page over again and rips the skin off the photo of him being admired by the girl in the doorway of his bedroom. Smoke rushes up and snakes in through the top of Kim's head, fills him and clicks into place inside, so he speaks through a mask with eye holes, while an orange liquid flows into the meat of his toes. And instead of his girlfriend in the doorway, there hangs a congeries of dancing blood, droplets in the air, in the shape of a human, which coalesce into a wolf standing upright on two bloody legs at the threshold of his bedroom, then hungry at the end of his bed, looking down at Kim with eyes gleaming wet and dead above a dark mouth hole. Kim snaps back to Kelly's office and stands up, shaken, dropping the brochure to the floor. Kelly looks up at him with a sporty smile. "So, Kim, investment banking, is it, then, yes?" she inquires. "You won't regret it." Thanks for your help, Miss Candy, but I don't think I'm convinced, sorry. I'll keep you posted, thank you," he replies and heads for the door. Jamie flops down in the gods above and exhales in relief. Jesus, this beast creation is a perilous business.